I don't know exactly what physics looks like at high energy. I may not have any fields there to describe reality. I may need to use a different tool. I may need to use strings. I may need to use something else yet I haven't even thought about. I don't know, but it doesn't matter too much because what I'm thinking about is amplitude of probabilities of given outcomes. And I don't really need to understand what are the fundamental blocks of nature at very high energy. But what I do know is when I make a link between high energy and I go down to lower and lower energy, I can sum up probabilities. And so, for instance, if I am at low energy and I take two electrons, let's say I take two particles and I scatter them together at a given energy, they're going to interact and lots of different things can happen. And what can happen depends a little bit on all of high energy physics, but all other additional contributions should add up positively to some quantities related to the amplitude of probability. So whatever, if I have other particles that come in there that come and play along in the game, all they can do is add up for a new outcome, which will give an additional positive contribution to potential, to the realm of possibilities. So this is really what the positivity bounds are in some sense. It's embedded in this notion of unitarity, but you don't need to go into the details. It's very much into when thinking that when I scatter things, so the scattering, this is what is encoded in this S matrix. That's why we're talking about the S matrix. Mm-hmm. I can look at the different possible outcomes. And if I have more and more physics coming in at high energy, that opens more and more possibilities, or it opens up more and more contributions to the potential outcomes, but they will bring in positive contribution. I don't want anything which may lead me to negative contributions, because otherwise I could simply focus on this and end up with a probability which doesn't make sense, which is negative, let's say. So these are what the positivity bounds are. Conceptually, you can think they're quite simple. They're quite simple to understand, that things should add up constructively and positively. Of course, it's a bit more mathematical than that. What I'm saying is a little bit simplified. It's not entirely correct, I should say, but it's just to give you the gist of it, a little bit of the taste of it. But the beauty of this is that it enables you to make a connection between an unknown high energy completion. I don't know what it is. All I know is possibilities, contribution to an amplitude of probability at high energy, and then some potential outcome at low energy and some realization, some models at low energy. And so I can, from that, have a model at low energy, which I'll call it an effective description. It's an effective quantum field description for the world at low energy. For instance, the standard model of particle physics, I can think of it as a low-energy effective quantum field theory. It's valid up to a given energy scale.
Uh-huh.
And even general relativity, I can think of it as an effective quantum field description. It's a quantum field theory, and an effective one, which makes sense. It makes complete sense. It's consistent. Everything goes well. There's absolutely no problem up to a given energy scale. And it's only when I start looking at things at a high energy scale, and I can think of doing scattering processes that involves gravity, when I start doing this at energy scales which are comparable to the Planck scale, then I start producing black holes and all sorts of funny things happen. And if I were just to take general relativity with nothing else at high energy, I would seem to break this outcome of unitarity, break this notion that the probability should sum up to one. So this is really the issue, and this is why we know that something else has to come up to compensate for that. But now I can just take effective descriptions at low energy, the quantum field theories, and just consider amplitudes of probability at low energy and ask myself whether their behavior, and their behavior as a function of energy and different parameters which are related to some extent to energy, is consistent with what I would have expected had it come from a consistent high energy theory. And so, as I mentioned before, for some of those models, we already know that they will not be consistent. An interesting thing is that sometimes you can look at it at low energy and nothing wrong seemed to happen. In principle, there could be an okay description as an effective perturbative quantum field theory. They may be consistent, but then we know that, in fact, they're never going to be linked. To link them to a high energy completion, something bad has to happen somewhere along the way. There needs to be some negative contribution somewhere along the way, and that can't happen. Otherwise, we could just focus on this negative contribution and everything will be unstable, everything will be bad. So now you can do that for all sorts of theories that you have out there, including for massive gravity. Now, for massive gravity, there's a very nice paper, actually, by Chang and Raman from 2015 or 2016. Maybe it was 2016. It's called Positive Signs in Massive Gravity. So massive gravity comes up with different parameters for interactions. There's different parameters that come in. And then they show that there's an island of possibility among this parameter space where those positivity bounds are satisfied. So for the theory to be consistent and to be embeddable with a high energy completion, you need to be within a region of parameter space. And that was quite nice because before, in fact, we anticipated that there would be no region of parameter space where it would ever be embeddable in a standard high energy completion, and you always needed something which is quite different. So even the possibility for this to happen is quite interesting in its own right. And then there's been a series of other papers since then that show that if you make further assumption and you push those bounds further and further, in particular, if you make some assumption which are stronger based on weakly coupled high energy completion, then you can't have the theory being embedded, massive gravity being embeddable in a standard high energy completion. So that we know. So for massive gravity to have a high energy completion, it can't be just a weakly coupled, more, let me say, perturbative approach. I have something more in mind when I say that, but it can't be just a weakly coupled high energy completion. It will have to be something quite different, which may be interesting, but makes it also quite challenging. So this is the statue of that. But in fact, just exploring those possibilities has enabled us to understand a whole other realm of different theories and how and when they can be potentially embeddable in a high energy completion. So one route of this is to explore much more deeply what the consequences of having a more strongly coupled high energy completion would be. I think to my mind, this is really very interesting, but it's also very challenging. So what we know is that you have to redress some of the coupling constant that come in the situation, and the rules of the games become quite different, but also very challenging to keep track of. So very little progress has been made in those directions for massive gravity. For other things, a lot of progress have been made, but not for massive gravity. But another completely different direction is simply to use those positivity bounds, not for massive gravity, but all sorts of different effective descriptions that we have out there. And for instance, for particle physics, we understand now that we have the standard model of particle physics that includes the Higgs. But if you were to ask the community 10 years ago, even 13 years ago, they would have told you that one would have hoped to observe something beyond the standard model, which is based on particular models coming from high energy realization. So either some signs of supersymmetry or some particular models that would have come in. And the reality is nothing has emerged. We haven't seen anything beyond the standard of particle physics, but we know that it would be hard for it to be just the standard model of particle physics. We would have expected something else to come in. At the very least, we know that we have to couple it with gravity at some point, that the neutrinos have masses. Maybe that's not really the big issue, but at some point, at least before the Planck scale, something has to come in. And we believe that something will have to come in even at a much lower energy scale than that. But before, we were driven much more by beautiful very well thought out specific realizations at high energy, some specific models, which come up with their specific signatures at low energy. And unfortunately, nothing has been found along those realms. So nowadays, quite a different approach has been taken, where people are looking at what we call the SMEFT, the Standard Model Effective Field Theory, where instead of looking for specific model-dependent signatures, they're looking for all possibilities. So they parameterize the corrections that you can have beyond the standard model of particle physics. It's the SMEFT. So you're looking at corrections, which will become more and more important at high energy, that go beyond the standard model of particle physics. But there's thousands of those. And so those positivity bounds can enable us to see where in this big region of parameter space you can be connected with a sensible high energy completion and which regions you are not. And so that allows us to make tractions and focus in sensible regions in parameter space for physics beyond the standard model without being focused on specific model dependent, only focusing on a consistent high energy completion. And this consistency is just a notion of causality and unitarity.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.